Welcome, everyone. Welcome. My name is Brianne Roth. I'm the Public Programs Coordinator here at the Nantucket Historical Association. I want to thank you all for joining us. This is our third Food for Thought for the year, so thank you for coming. Before we get things started, if everyone could please take a moment to silence your cell phones and make sure that they do not disrupt today's lecture. Before we get things started, I'd like to take a moment to say that all of our programs here at the NHA are made possible with support from our members. Your NHA membership helps us accomplish all that we do every single day. So if you're one of our members, we thank you. And if you have not joined yet, please do visit our friendly folks at the front desk and they can help you with an NHA membership. Today's Food for Thought is brought to you by the MS Worthington Foundation, and media sponsorship is generously provided by Novation Media. Today's lecture features one of our own, Michael Harrison, our Robyn and John Davis Chief Curator. Prior to joining the NHA in 2014, he had worked as a museum curator and historian for 18 years. He has served as an exhibition coordinator at the National Building Museum in Washington, D.C., as a historian and associate curator in the Maritime Collections at the Smithsonian's National Museum of American History, and as a project curator of oral histories and photographs for the Riverside Museum in Glasgow, Scotland. In his position as the Robyn and John Davis Curator, he is responsible for the management, care, research, and interpretation of NHA holdings in fine and decorative arts, and historic and prehistoric artifacts. Please join me in giving a warm welcome to Michael Harrison.
Thank you. Welcome, everybody. It's nice to be up in front of you all again. Here at the NHA, we collect all aspects of Nantucket's history, and the most obvious and largest portion of that is obviously the whaling and the legacy of whaling that we have here. As, of course, you can all tell and know very well, we've dedicated an entire museum to that subject, although we certainly could dedicate additional museums to additional subjects in Nantucket history. It is such a rich topic. But among our whaling holdings, our logbook collection is definitely one of our gems. We have quite a number of books. From Nantucket voyages, we also hold ones from voyages from New Bedford and elsewhere. And I'm happy to say we're hoping to get a fair number of them digitized sometime soon to help researchers who are more far-flung, who have trouble coming here to look in them and use them, and also to aid their preservation from handling and all of that. But today's talk is based on one of these logbooks. And every time we open up one of these books, we always find that there's a rich world there of adventures that we didn't necessarily know about beforehand. And there are, of course, certain commonalities among whaling voyages, one to the next, but then each voyage also has different and unusual things that happen in it. So today, I want to look at one particular voyage of the ship Constitution. As it says on the screen, a voyage that lasted from 1847 to 52. 4.5 years, particularly long voyage. There were two vessels named Constitution that sailed from Nantucket. This one that we're going to talk about today was built in 1821 in Hanover, Massachusetts, a region where many whaling ships from Nantucket were built. It was built for and originally owned by Zenas Coffin, a well-known local Nantucket merchant and ship owner. He owned the ship from 1821 to 1830. And then sold it, or it passed to, Charles G. and Henry Coffin, also very well-known family members there, owning ships and running factories and processing oil. They owned it from 1830 to 1856. It was then condemned at Nantucket in 1856 and broken up. Over those 35 years, the ship made 12 whaling voyages, lasting between 2 and 5 years. We don't actually know what the ship Constitution looked like, but we can guess, because we know its tonnage. It was 325 tons. That's quite small. That's in the sort of 80 to 100 foot range. This is one of the paintings in our collection of the whale ship Spermo. It's about the same size, built at almost exactly the same period, in almost exactly the same place. So this is, we have two paintings of the Spermo in our collection. There's a beautiful one at the Athenaeum. We also have one on loan at the moment upstairs in our Whaleship Essex exhibition. If you haven't seen them, do check them out. It's very unusual to have views, contemporary views of Nantucket whaling ships done in oil, multiple views of the same ship from exactly the same voyage. But this is much what we think the Constitution would have looked like, a ship of about this size, crew of perhaps 20, probably no more than 25. this ship, the Constitution, aside from the voyage we're going to talk about today, there's not a whole lot that's out of the way or particularly remarkable about her, although on her 10th voyage out of 12, she was the first ship carried out of Nantucket Harbor on the Camels, on the floating dry dock that we have the model of in the next room. Not the first ship to use the Camels. The Camels were first used to bring a ship into the harbor, but this was the first ship to be carried out of the harbor in the Camels, a scene which would have looked something like this, with the steamer Telegraph towing the dry dock on its way with the ship. This is a rather later depiction with a pretty giant whale ship going out. But the voyage that I want to talk about today was commanded by Obed R. Bunker. This is Obed R. Bunker in his retirement from a glass plate negative in our collection. Quite a beautiful view, probably by Henry Wire, but we're not totally certain of that. This man was born in 1815, and by many standards, he started his nautical career rather late. He first went to sea at the age of 17, and that was in 1832 on the sixth voyage of the ship Constitution that we're talking about. His career then progressed in a very typical fashion for somebody who wanted to actually make a career out of being a whaler. As many of you probably know, many people who went whaling, they signed on for one voyage, they learned what they needed to do, they were away for 3 years, and they never set foot on a whaling ship again because it was so horrible. It was hard work, it was awful, you weren't treated well by other sailors on other vessels. But if you wanted to progress to command and have the opportunity to actually make some money at this, you would stay on voyage after voyage, learn the skills, and work your way up. And this is exactly what Obed Bunker did. So as I said, he went on his first voyage at age 17 in 1832. In 1833, he signed on to the Constitution again, and this time, instead of being a mere sailor, he was a boat steerer, so he's one of the harpooners on board. 1835, again 2 years later, he signs on for the eighth voyage of the Constitution. By this point, he's signed on as third mate. And his captain at that point is Edward Joy. Then 1839, the very next voyage, he's first mate. So he's like one voyage to the next, you know, you're out 2 years at a time. It's not gonna take you very long to, very many voyages that is, to progress up the ladder. So on his voyage as first mate, this was an extremely successful voyage. The ship brought back more than 2,100 barrels of oil. That is a very large number, and a lot to be carried in a vessel that's this size. Although we do know that some of those barrels would have been shipped home previous to the end of the voyage, a quite common practice, that you would get a certain amount and then you'd ship it home to free up space in your hold. So then we get to Bunker's, how many voyages are we up to? One, two, three, four, five, fifth voyage. He's the master of the ship after five voyages. He takes out the Constitution in 1842 and again encounters a lot of success and comes home with 1,800 barrels of oil. After returning from this voyage, which he comes back in about 1846, about a four-year voyage, he marries Emily Morton here on island, and then promptly departs again on another voyage. Not an uncommon practice, mostly because the voyages were very close together, not because people were, you know, so anxious to flee away after they had gotten married. Although who knows, maybe. So it's the 11th voyage of the Constitution, and this, his sixth voyage and his second voyage as captain, that we're going to talk about today, where they head off to the Pacific, searching for whales. This is where most Nantucketers go at this period. But then they end up in the Arctic, because they hear good word that there's good hunting in the Arctic, and that will form the main crux of our story today. Just to briefly finish up with Captain Bunker before we go ahead, He stays as a captain after his years as a whaling captain, but he actually leaves whaling aside and he becomes a merchant captain in the 1850s. And he's captain of the clipper ship Reindeer in 1853 and takes that ship to California and breaks a number of records around Cape Horn, which is fairly significant. He then returns to whaling aboard the Spartan of Nantucket in 1858 to 63. And at that point, he retires just about the age of 50. Comes to the island, and then he passes away in 1904, I would say within 10 years of this picture being taken, if not less. So, of course, he didn't sail the ship around the world alone. This map, all these purple spots, these are the places that the crew of the Constitution came from on the voyage we're talking about today. We do not have a complete crew list for this voyage, but we are able to glean from the logbook the names of about 15 people who sailed on the ship and some of their roles, and then we can extrapolate either from notes in the logbook or from their names where they were from. So, of course, we all know about Obed Bunker. We've just been talking about him. He was 32 at the time the ship sailed in 1847. And, of course, he's the master. We don't know who the first or second mates are on this voyage at this point, but we do know that the third mate was a man named George Prince. He was about 19 at the time they sailed. We believe he was a Nantucketer, although Prince is not a super common Nantucket name. But we have found references to his father here, so we presume he was, too. We know that there was an African-American man named Henry Green, who was from New Bern, North Carolina. He was also about the age of 21. We know that William Byrd was a man from England, and he was in his 40s, so probably a professional mariner at this point, but not absolutely certain about that. We have a William Mallory from New York, also about 20. Teens and 20s, of course, is typical for ages for going on these voyages. We then have Manuel Francisco, who's from Flores in the Azores, also very typical on whaling voyages, both out of here and out of New Bedford. They would make a stop in the Atlantic Islands to get additional provisions and to fill out their crew. There were also many people who were born in the Azores who were living on Nantucket, having returned on whaling voyages. So we don't know whether Manuel Francisco signed on at the Azores or not, but he's referred to it in the logbook as being from there. So we know that. We know that there are some other people who are probably Azorean or Cape Verdean in the crew. A man named Joe Silvia is referred to in passing. We have a Manuel Domingo, who is from South America. We have a Charles Castello of Peru. And then we have a man from Hawaii named John Adams. He is probably Hawaiian native. He probably has a native name. He took on another name in order to simplify record keeping, or one was imposed upon him, which was often fairly common. So John Adams, a patriotic name being picked. And then we have some English names as well, so we think we're some other Englishmen, but it's very common on Nantucket whaling ships and New Bedford whaling ships for the bulk of the crew not to be from Nantucket. The ownership is here, the captain is here, the mates are often here, but not always. But then the crew comes from wherever they can get crew. Anybody who's willing to do this will gladly be signed aboard. And so consequently, it's a very international group who, you know, as the ship goes around the world, they have people on board who speak the languages where they're going. There are these sort of cultural connections that are kind of important and interesting aboard these vessels. So let's turn then to this specific voyage. 4.5 years going around the world in search of whales. Just to give a little context to this, at the time of this voyage, 1847, there are 74 whale ships that are registered in the port of Nantucket. Of those, about 10 are in port at any one time. So 64 Nantucket whalers off across the world. Then there's another 100, 150 whalers from New Bedford at this point out across the world, plus ones from other New England ports. There are ones from Britain, there are ones from Germany. There's very few Spanish and French ones, a few from Australia. I saw one from Hobart, Australia. The other day, which is very unusual. Well, not unusual to the Australians, unusual from our perspective. So then the Constitution is one of 13 of these ships that actually set sails in 1847. So you sort of get a sense of, you know, we have this big whaling fleet. Much of it is out at sea at any one time. About 10 of it is here. 10 to 15 of it is sailing at any one time. There's a sort of constant motion going on. But, you know, there are, you know, 1,000 or so Nantucketers off on these ships around the world at any one point at this time. Their route is pretty typical. Of course, they start here. The red dots are on the way out, the green dots are on the way back. I did not have the patience to go through every entry in the logbook and map out their exact path. Someday maybe I'll do that. But of course, they go across, and they stop in the Atlantic Islands, again, to provision stuff. They head down, they're whaling off the islands here, and then they go up the coast of Chile and Peru, out to the Galapagos for provisioning, out near Tahiti, and then they head up here, and this will be something we get to in a moment. A very, very typical voyage. You know, it's not unknown to go this way around and go hunt in the Indian Ocean. Famously, this is what the fictional Pequod does. But most voyages go this way around because this is traditionally where they're going to find most of the whales. Although they do, various ships do find a fair number of whales through here. Then the offshore ground is this area through here in the middle of nowhere. The Essex that we all know about was stove by a whale out here, having done exactly this kind of voyage for the first year that it was out. But also traipsing through all of these islands is also quite common. So they're out there, Cape Verde, coast of Chile, Peru, Ecuador, the Galapagos Islands, where they pick up turtles like everybody else does on the way. This was not, however, a super easy voyage. They encounter the normal amounts of weather. They don't. There's no reports in the logbook of particularly harsh weather where they, you know, lose equipment or have massive damage. But they do encounter weather. But they have trouble finding whales. So out of this 4.5 year voyage, within a, you know, if you you take off the first and last number of months when they're sort of getting somewhere, 4 years, they capture 17.5 whales. They may ask, how can they capture half a whale? That was, they shared a whale with the ship Rambler of Nantucket. Both ships hunted this whale together in company in December of 1849. They caught it together. They tried it out together. They split the oil. So they, it was, it's accounted in the logbook as half a whale. But 17.5 whales is not very many. And they returned home with 555 barrels of sperm oil and 90 barrels of whale oil. Again, to put that in perspective, the two voyages previous, this ship brought home 2,100 barrels of oil, four times as much. And then the previous voyage, 1,800 barrels, three and some odd as much. So in 4.5 years, they get 500 barrels of sperm oil and 90 of whale oil. This is really actually quite bad. So they're not having good luck. Of all this stuff, 50 barrels they ship home early. Probably in the early part of the voyage where they're feeling optimistic that they're going to get a lot more and you're going to need the hold space. But they, there's actually a notation. This is November 17th, 1851, 3 years into the voyage. These are the only sperm whales we've seen for nearly 20 months. Imagine going to your office and doing nothing for 20 months except looking around, trying to find that paper you were supposed to print. It's kind of like that. So in addition to the frustration of not being able to find very many whales, the ship had difficulties keeping crew members. As I mentioned, we don't know exactly how many people were aboard. We think it's around 20, which would be typical for a ship of this size. Eight men desert the ship in the course of the voyage in five separate incidents, all of them on the west coast of South America. Four of those are recaptured and returned to the ship by the local authorities. These include the men William Mallory, Samuel Lees, John Bro, or Broff, I'm not quite sure with that one, who all deserted at Santa Peru in October of 1848 and were caught and returned to the ship 10 days later. We then have in the logbook a reference to a man named Sam Diego, who deserted at Payeta, Peru in February of 49, and he's recovered 18 days later. This also tells us a bit about them stopping for provisioning and stopping to look for additional crew members because people are fleeing. The fact that they're still there 18 days later for this man to come back on board says something about the pace of their voyage. But there are incidences and deaths aboard the voyage. Here we return to one of our brilliant paintings of the Spermo standing in for the Constitution. Ship Spermo in a heavy squall, 1822. What's remarkable about these paintings is that all the men in this are doing exactly what they would need to be doing if, in fact, the ship were caught in a squall suddenly with more sails aloft than they should have had. So all these men are running up the correct lines, they're running up the correct side of the ship, they're all going to the right kinds of things, which is pretty incredible. And if this looks like fun, it probably wasn't. Among the incidents of this voyage, they have a collision with the Peruvian bark Orlinda in 1848 in the middle of the night, which destroyed one whale boat, but doesn't seem to have done any other damage to either vessel. They had three boats stove by whales, so their boats would have been, of course, very similar to this. So imagine being in a boat like this in the middle of the ocean and having a whale destroy it. and then hoping your friends are nearby in the other boats. Charles Castello of Peru fell overboard from the four topmast cross tree. So since I have a laser pointer, he's basically here, and he falls off. He bounces off a brace and falls into the ocean, and miraculously is rescued. His head was badly cut, and he was bruised, but he survived. Falls of this kind were not unheard of. Bouncing off of the rigging into the sea was also not unheard of, although falling onto the deck was also common and usually much more fatal. If you fell overboard in a particular storm, generally that was the end of you because they couldn't turn around fast enough to find you. This man was quite lucky. But there were six men who died on the voyage. We have two men, a Henry Green and a William Byrd, who both died of exposure after their boat was stove by a whale in December of 1847, and the other boat could not come upon them fast enough. We have third mate, George W. Prince of Nantucket, who was ill for 7 weeks. He's described as having an illness of liver, and we don't know more than that, and he died after 7 weeks of that. William Mallory of New York, age 22, died of pleurisy. Our friend Manuel Francisco of the Azores, who I referred to earlier, he was 38. He died of a stomach inflammation. And then John Adams, our friend from Hawaii, at age 28, died after 6 weeks illness. And so we don't know much more than that. And of course, the medical treatment would have only been proffered by the captain, who was responsible for the health of the crew, had the one medicine chest aboard, probably had one of the standard guidebooks of sailor's medicine, and would have been largely at a loss as to what to do for these kinds of things, as indicated by the vagueness of which their maladies are listed. So if this all sounds very bleak and desolate, sailing through the middle of nowhere looking for whales, being totally cut off from everything, they are in fact a little less cut off than we might imagine. The logbook lists every ship that they encounter. Many of these, of course, just we sighted a sail on the horizon, and that's all it says. But very often, they spoke another vessel. Vessels would come close enough. They would perhaps do a gam, although we don't have many gams actually recorded here. But certainly, they would yell across the gap of sea, what ship are you, where are you bound, how many barrels of oil are you carrying? They spoke more than 100 vessels in the course of this voyage. These are all the references to vessels that they speak. All the ones in red are Nantucket ships, which is about a quarter of the ships. So not necessarily that all these ships would have news from Nantucket, because they'd all been out at sea for a while themselves, but some of them were more recently out than others, and the Constitution herself would have been more recently out than some of the others, and they would have exchanged information back and forth. There probably would have been family connections, people they knew. Of course, all the Nantucket captains know all the other Nantucket captains, and in this list, we have such ships as the Rambler, which is the one they shared the whale with, of course. We expect they would have spoken there. The ship Enterprise, which we have a logbook from in the collection. The ship Nauticon, which is Captain Veeder's ship, Veeder here on the back wall, who went whaling with his wife a few years after this, and then later had many adventures in the Pacific. The Anne Alexander, which is famous for having been stove by a whale. The second ship known to have done that after the Essex is in this list. So they do have a lot of contact, and they're really interested in professional matters when they have these talks. How many whales do you have? Where did you get them? Where should we be going? And it's in the course of this kind of contact that the Obed Bunker discovers that whalers have been having success in the Arctic, which is not, at this point, a place that very many Nantucketers have gone. Some have gone, but generally they're staying in the Pacific. They're in the offshore ground, they're in the Japan ground, they're further down in the South Pacific. But in 1848, so remember the Constitution has sailed in 47, in the summer of 48, the Bark Superior of Sag Harbor, under Captain Royes, went into the Arctic. We're not exactly certain why, but he was nearby and thought, well, let's see what's up here. And he had huge success capturing whales. He was not particularly looking for sperm whales, nor did he find any there, but he found baleen whales, and he returned with 1,700 barrels of whale oil and 23,000 pounds of baleen, To put that in perspective, that's a lot. A lot of baleen from one voyage. Numbers of that size for non-steam whalers is quite high. So he, you know, summer of 1848, the only time he can enter the Arctic, it's not iced over. He then sails back south. The news of his great success spreads as soon as the news reaches San Francisco, Honolulu, Panama, and other places where it can be carried by steamship or telegraph back to the East Coast. So a year later, the summer of 1849, 154 American whale ships decide the Arctic's the place to go. And they go there. And altogether, these 154 American whale ships are carrying 4,600 American sailors into the Arctic, where they come home with 207,000 barrels of whale oil and 2.5 million pounds of whale bone. So a huge killing in a small span of time. And this is the area we're talking about. This is the Aleutian Islands, Alaska on the right, Russia, Siberia on the left, Japan down this way. This success, so we've got the Superior in 1848, we have 154 ships in 1849, we have 141 American ships that go in the summer of 1850, again, 4,000 sailors, equal numbers in terms of barrels of oil, but 3.7 million pounds of baleen. That's a lot of buggy whips and umbrellas. So this then gets us to the summer of 1851. By January of 1851, the Constitution, sailing through the middle of the Pacific, had taken only 15 whales and has somewhere 300 to 400 barrels of oil in the hold. This is a very poor showing, having been out for 3.5 years. So, but they're speaking to all these other ships, and so they've heard the news that over a number of seasons, people have had good success in the Arctic. So Captain Bunker takes the ship to the Arctic. In May of 1851, they enter the Bering Sea by passing between these islands here, Argatu and Ato, I'm sure somebody can correct me on those, in the Western Aleutians. So they sort of aim for here so they don't go astray, and they sail up, and then they follow the Siberian coast up through here looking for whales. And the whale ships are all in this region, in this huge part of the straits. A few whalers are able to get up here. The ice is about at this point in the middle of summer. But basically, our ship only goes that far. Because once they're here, they're also talking to the other ships and seeing what's going on. June 2nd, 1851, by this point, they are here. The logbook records thick fog, light breezes, all sail set, trying to get to the north. 6 days later, off Cape Thaddeus in Anadyr Sea, that is in this region, the logbook records, land 15 miles distant at noon. The ice extends about 5 miles from the shore, apparently soft and much broken. We have seen between 50 and 60 ships during this 24 hours, all, like ourselves, looking for whales. Only one out of the fleet boiling, meaning they've actually caught something. All, I suppose, came here with the expectation of getting a cargo of oil this season, but I can see but little prospect of it. He's only been there for 6 days, and he's already pessimistic. So then toward the end of June, they've been sailing around and around sort of in this area with everybody else, hoping that whales appear. He writes in the logbook, lowered the boats for whales, but could not get near them. And then we get to July 16th, 1851. And what's a pretty remarkable thing in our logbook, this is the passage I'm going to read. This is what, of course, the logbook looks like. Logbooks don't always make great things to display, but they are really quite rich with information and detail. And for goodness sakes, teach your children how to read cursive, because they're going to need it. Or else this stuff's going to be lost to history. So this, the red part that I've marked, this is July 16th, 1851. First part, light breeze eastward. Thick fog most of the time. Saw a polar whale at 6 p.m. There's no such thing as a polar whale, but he doesn't know what it is yet, and it's in the north, so that's what he calls it. Lowered the boats in pursuit, but saw nothing more of him after he went down. Middle part, calm. Then he writes, we were visited by four canoes with about 25 natives in them from the shore. They brought aboard a few walrus teeth, skins, and some other trifling articles to trade for tobacco or liquor, which they seemed to be very fond of. But we had but little or none of either for them. Okay, I'm going to pause there for a second before I continue with the quote. The red dot is about where they are when the natives come to talk to them. So these are Siberian, natives of the Siberian Peninsula, Inuit. Now, of course, you know, I've been saying that they have all this contact with all these other whalers. They see all these people. They talk. They have very few actual interactions with native people in the Pacific on this particular voyage. They don't stop at the Marquesas. They don't stop at Tahiti. They stop at Hawaii later. But they really, you know, the lens they bring with them is the lens they bring with them. And he is certainly wearing that lens full here. I'm going to continue. I must say they were the hardest specimens of humanity I ever met with. I had thought we whalemen were dirty at times, but I must say I never saw filthy people before. Oh my word. He then concludes, they stayed 2 or 3 hours and then left us, and I was glad when they were gone. So there's a lot there. You wish he had written more. I mean, on the one hand, it's like, okay, you didn't have a very open mind with this. But on the other hand, what bearings did he have for this encounter? You know, he's from Nantucket. He knows all these Nantucketers. He's whaling. They're out for profit. They're out for whales. He's never met these kind of people before. He's never been in the Arctic before. You know, what is he supposed to think? We would all hope that we would be more enlightened, perhaps, than he, and realize whatever conditions those people might have been living in. But he is a person of his time, and he did spend 2 or 3 hours with them. This is really quite remarkable. It's not like he didn't let them land. He didn't listen to what they wanted to trade for. They actually were there for quite a long time. So this is actually, I think, very, very remarkable. Alas, it is the only reference, not the only reference to native peoples in the logbook, but the only one where they actually have a conversation and speak and come aboard. So he's there. This was July 16th. We're now going to move on a couple of days, and we have some additional quotes from the logbook that I'm going to read because I find this quite interesting. You know, they're not hunting whales, but they're there with everybody else. So July 22nd, 1851, at 8 p.m., anchored off a small island in the Bering Straits near the mainland in latitude 6440 north. Found the bark Friends of New London at anchor, employed in saving the oil from the Armada of New London, who was wrecked on a reef near the island some 10 or 12 days ago. We went to the wreck and got 3 loads of wood. Captain Holt of the Armada informs us that at the time his ship was wrecked, or soon after, he had difficulty on board the wreck with some of the natives from shore, in which 1 Englishman and 6 or 8 natives were killed, the Englishman belonging to a Sydney vessel at anchor here. Rumor also says rum was the cause of the trouble. So he doesn't think anything about going and getting 3 loads of wood from the ship. It's not quite clear whether they were given or whether they just opportunistically took them. But then everybody is upset that the natives are coming out to the wreck hoping to find something. So we already see that this season in the Arctic is not proving to go well. Not only are people not finding whales, ships are getting wrecked, and they're having less than friendly encounters with the people there, possibly for reasons of their own. So then a few days later, he says he spoke to the Montpelier, Captain Tucker, who reported ships are doing nothing in the polar sea. No whales seen there. Reported the loss of the Arbella under Captain Maxfield, the Henry Thompson, Captain Holmes, both lost amongst the ice, which makes 8 ships this season lost, 3 amongst ice and 5 ashore in the fog. So we're going to skip ahead a little bit. This is a few months later. In one of the newspapers in San Francisco, which received a report from returning whalers. By the arrival of the steamer Cherokee at New York from Shangri-La in Panama, we have accounts at San Francisco from the Arctic, including reports of about 60 American whalers, or nearly half of the Arctic Ocean fleet. These accounts were brought to us by the Nile, blah, 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 how they got this information. Basically saying, all the reports are as bad as you've heard. They're not capturing any whales. Ships are being destroyed, general failure of the fleet to procure oil, owing to heavy weather, ice, and fogs. Of the whole number of ships thus far heard from, only 1 had obtained a full cargo, while a great majority of the others had taken no oil or only a few hundred barrels. So this is really bad. There's you know, thousands of American sailors there, hundreds of ships, and nothing is being captured. I don't know how many of you can actually read this tiny print here, but if you notice the second paragraph down near the bottom, by the same arrival, we have the report of the loss of the ship Anne Alexander of this port, a full account of which we found in today's paper, which is the next column I didn't put on the screen. As I alluded to earlier, the Anne Alexander was stove by a whale in the offshore ground earlier in 1851, and it's the second reported sinking of an American whale ship by a whale after the Essex. Somewhat famously, the crew survived. They were picked up within a few days. They were taken to Hawaii. There was no great cataclysm as with the Essex. But a year or so later, another whale ship, a Nantucket whale ship, captured a whale and found harpoons from the Anne Alexander in that whale and presumed that that was the whale that sank the Anne Alexander. And they saved three of the teeth, scrimshawed them up, and gave them to the captain of the Anne Alexander as a gift, and we have them upstairs in our scrimshaw gallery. So a happy coincidence that happens, that story intersects with this one as we go. So if we return to Captain Bunker and his crew, having braved the Arctic for the first time ever, they discover that their efforts are wasted. So July 1851, they decide to steer south in company with the Enterprise, another Nantucket vessel, Captain Swain. In August of 51, they lower the boats after walruses, and they catch four. That's at least something. And then on August 25th, 1851, we are leaving the Arctic astern very far and without the least regret either. And in September of 1851, they sight their islands at the end of the Aleutians, and they're on their way. So they're there from May to September. They capture four walruses. They have an unfortunate encounter with the natives, and that's that. So then they decide to go to Hawaii. Don't take any whales along the way. And then it's clear that from Hawaii, they decide to go home. The distance home, of course, is very great, so they're still hunting whales on their way home, but the logbook says, the top of the pages, bound for Nantucket, bound for the Cape, bound for Nantucket, so they're clearly thinking of going home. A successful voyage in the Pacific by this point, if they were still in the Pacific, would have thrown their try works overboard, you know, when they were full, as a signal to the crew, yes, we really are going home, we're not hunting any more whales, we're not delaying. This ship doesn't throw their try works overboard until they're past Bermuda in the Atlantic, which, you know, is also an indication that things weren't going very well. After they leave the Arctic in September of 1851, they do capture two more whales. I'll get to this one in a second. Those two whales are captured in November of 51 after they've left Hawaii, and then one in January of 1852. So that's their last whale, 17 and a half for 4.5 years' work. And then there's this note. They're on their way home. They've rounded Cape Horn. They're headed up the coast of Argentina. And in February of 1852, they speak the Samuel Robertson of Fairhaven, Captain Washburn, 30 months out. All right, for perspective there, our heroes are 53 months out. They have 550 barrels of oil, remember? The Samuel Roberts, 30 months out, 3,500 barrels whale, 100 barrels sperm. So a very successful voyage. They plan to cruise 1 month and then home. So this would have been kind of dispiriting. What are we missing? We've gone to the same seas and have not had the same success. But as I said, they don't throw their try works overboard for another 2 months, hoping that maybe they'll sail past something, maybe they'll be able to catch something. They're 200 miles west-northwest of Bermuda when the logbook finally says, threw the try works overboard. Although for a number of weeks before that, the logbook is filled with references to painting. Painting on deck, painting below, painting inside, meaning in the cabin. Clearly they're headed home, they want to look better. They're repairing sails, they're doing various other kinds of repairs. They're prettying up the ship to return home. And the logbook ends as they sail around the east side of Nantucket into the sound, and they basically say, in company with many sail, into the sound. And they don't write that they actually got home, but we know they did, with not much to show for it. This is just for color. I love these cribbage boards. with these scenes of whaling of what they hoped would happen. Here we've picked a single whaling voyage. Let's see what's in this logbook. The logbook has all kinds of twists and turns to it. You know, a less successful voyage than we'd like to think. You know, we often talk about Nantucket's fortunes were built on whaling. Nantucket was a wealthy place at two specific points in its history because of whaling. And that changed due to technological factors and competitions from other ports. But it's not like every vessel is bringing back, liquid gold every single time. It is a market. You're hunting natural resources. The natural resources ebb and flow for reasons that were not well understood at the time. Scientists now are studying why there were so many whales in the Arctic in 1848, 49, and 50, and why they all disappeared in 1851. What was that had to do with food sources? What did that have to do with the ice? You know, there's new scholarship being done on that. None of these people would have realized that. They're basically out there, a bit by the seat of their pants, trying to find this stuff, that when they do find it, leads to, great economic fortune for their island, but when they don't find it, leads to substantial losses. And other logbooks that we have would paint a different story, but with some similarities. As a closing note here to this particular voyage, I did look in our collection to see what we might have from the Constitution or from Obed Bunker or from any of the names that are preserved in the logbook. Aside from the beautiful portrait of Obed Bunker as an old man that we have in the collection, we don't have anything related to any of these other men. We don't have anything from the Constitution, although we have a beautiful half model and quarter board from the next ship Constitution that was built for the same owners and given the same name. But I did find an interesting object from Obed Bunker, which I have brought with me today. We have our gloves because it's a museum object. And I'll invite you to come up afterwards if you're interested. We have this nondescript hunk of seashells. Is our one surviving artifact from Obed Bunker. And we have a card from when it used to be on display at the Fair Street Museum many years ago. This is a piece of shell mortar found in the foundation of the main chimney in the house last owned and occupied by Captain Obed Bunker. House was located at 5 Fair Street and was torn down in 1906. And Mr. Henry Worth, in 1906, saved this out of the dirt and gave it to the NHA as a sample of early plaster work and mortar work on Nantucket. That happens by coincidence to be from Obed Bunker's house. And I will say, we have a substantial collection of fragments just like this from houses around the island where people are like, oh my God, I can't believe they used to use mortar like this. I can't believe their chimneys stood up, is the sort of subtext. We have a whole shelf filled with this stuff from different houses, pieces of wood, fragments of shingles, more cedar shakes than you can shake a stick at. And that's it. So if anybody has an old house on island and they find anything from Obed Bunker that's a little more exciting, please let us know. We are actively collecting Nantucket history. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Michael. We'll take a few minutes really quick. If anyone has any questions, I can come by. We have a question right here. I'll come to you first.
I'm wondering if you have any theories about their failure. Was it just bad luck, or was there anything
about else? What was happening that year with the winds,
or that ship, or were they incompetent?
I doubt that they were incompetent because Bunker had extremely successful voyages before, and had been on ships commanded by people who had successful voyages. I think it's a bit of a needle in a haystack kind of thing, that in all of the vast oceans of the world. Your tiny little ship, are going to try and find, the whales are big, but the ocean is bigger. And I really think that it's kind of luck of the draw. There certainly are professional skills involved here, reading the horizon, looking for things, knowing generally where these whales are going. But this is a few years before Maury at the Naval Observatory is sending out his charts of compiled data from whaling logbooks about where whales had been seen. They only have this sort of ad hoc on-the-job knowledge of where whales are and how that might change seasonally. And they try and follow that as best they can, but they themselves are subject to the vicissitudes of wind and weather. And they might end up, all the whales are 30 miles over there this year, and there's no way for them to know. So it is a bit of luck of the draw. I don't see any evidence here that they were that they had any sort of incompetence going on. Although I'm not quite sure how that would be reflected in the logbook, unless the captain were actively like denigrating his officers in his logbook, which I wouldn't put it past some of them. But I think it really is just luck of the draw.
Great.
When you talked about ships speaking ships, if they were speaking a ship that was not a Nantucket ship, I'm just thinking of the competition for whales, would they be really forthcoming with the whaling, where the whales are?
I don't know for certain on that. I haven't read a period account of somebody admitting one way or the other with that. I suspect a lot of that would, and this is just my conjecture, would come down to the personality of the individual captain. The degree to which the number of barrels a ship is carrying is freely shared among all ships and in all the newspapers indicates there is a certain freedom of information going, at least as far as, are you having a successful time of it? And it would be very unusual for a captain not to admit where they had come from or where they were headed. You know, but it's one thing to say, you know, we're 30 days out of we're 30 months, you know, out of Nantucket. You could have stopped any number of places on the way, and you might not be required to divulge that. But most captains at the time are certainly willing to say, we're bound for Honolulu, we're bound for the Arctic, you know. So I think there's probably some secretiveness to it, but I think there's also a sharing of information because they realize this is also difficult. But more primary source information on that, I think, would be very revealing about that question.
Yeah. We have a question right here.
Thank you, Michael, for sharing that story. I've heard so many about the successful whaling trips and the amazing what happened. And here was just a bunch of guys that worked really hard and then didn't make much money.
Yeah.
And they left in 47 after the town had burned up.
Yes. Yeah.
Said that. My question is just to understand the money, if you can, a little bit.
Yeah.
2,100 barrels on a really successful trip for the Constitution. What kind of money is that?
All right, so who's good at math in their head? The average price of a barrel of sperm oil in the middle of the 19th century is $28 a barrel. So that's lots of factors evened out. So 2,000 barrels of oil sold at $28 a barrel is, what is that, $56,000 at the dock. Now, of course, then we have to, you know, what's the price of bread kind of question. You know, what's the cost of that building when it's rebuilt in 1847? And I don't have that number right in my head, but that would be the way to compare it, would be to sort of do, you know, sort of figure that out and see. That is a substantial amount of money. I'm thinking this building is built for a few thousand dollars, but I might be wrong on that just offhand. You know, and of course, the cost of the voyage is, you know, taken out of that. There's, you know, various expenses and things to be done. But, you know, it's a lot. And for the people who own the ship, if the captain owns a share in addition to his lay for his work, the captain often makes a lot of money on this. The crew members less so, but everybody would make out very well on a 2,000 barrel voyage. And looking through the returns, if everybody doesn't know about it, the American Offshore Whaling Voyages, which is a research project that has a website hosted through Mystic Seaport, you can see all the known American whaling voyages in the 19th century and see what their returns are. And 2,000 barrels of oil is a lot by any standard for a ship of this period before 1850. So it's a lot.
Great. We have a question here and a question in the back, and then we'll wrap things up.
The meeting up with the natives, how were they communicating?
That is a very good question. It's not recorded in this logbook how, in fact, they're doing that. And there would have been a substantial language barrier. There are enough other ships in the area. I mean, it's conceivable that there may be people on other ships who know some of the language and have taught them a few things. I suspect, but I don't know for certain, because I'd have to go look in some other sources, that they're doing a lot with hand signals. They're doing a lot with sort of just mutual understanding. You know, people show up with trade goods. You know, how would you indicate that you were hoping for either drink or other things? There's probably a bit. I am imagining here that the language barrier is probably substantial. but the level of sort of understanding of needs and wants is probably greater than we might imagine. But there's huge room for misinterpretation. You know, the trope of the native peoples are always looking for alcohol, you know, is easy to impose on a situation where you may not understand what they're actually asking you. I'm sure there's actually been some good research on that, but I haven't read it yet. So check back with me and I'll see what we can find out.
We've got one more question back here.
Were some of the ships that were a little late in getting out and starting home, did any of them ever get iced in up there where they couldn't move out?
Yes, they did. And I meant to look up this date before I came today, and I've completely forgotten, and somebody will undoubtedly be able to tell me. There's a very famous event, I can't remember the year, it's in the next decade or so, when a dozen or more New Bedford ships and other ships get stuck in the Arctic all at the same time. They're all in the Bering Sea, they're all north of the Arctic Circle. The ice closes in, and they all have to abandon all of their ships. The fleet is completely lost. And there are thousands of American sailors stranded on the ice in the Arctic. It's a very famous event that you'd think I'd remember the date of today, but we can all find it. And you know, it's a substantial blow to New Bedford in particular. You know, but Arctic whaling continues well after that. Arctic whaling continues into the 20th century. But that, in fact, was a very common danger for that. I will throw in that. You know, something like the Essex, a famous story of cannibalism and difficulties while whaling, you know, and how horrible that kind of event was. Those kinds of cannibalism and you know, being stranded narratives often revolve around the Arctic. You know, ships that get stuck, Greenland, the Arctic on one side or the other of North America. Those kind of starvation narratives are much more common in those regions than they are in others. And there's a lot of actually worse things than the Essex that happen in the Arctic because of some of this. But yes, definitely, ships are being destroyed in the ice, whaling ships. Yeah.
Great. Well, thank you all for your questions. If you have any further questions, I'm sure Mike will be happy to talk to you one-on-one afterwards, as well as show you up close the artifact he brought with us. Thank you all for coming today. Let's have one more big round of applause. Many thanks to Michael.
Thank you, everybody.
Next week, we will have Laura Burnett, Dr. Tim Leppery, and Nantucket Chief of Police Bill Pittman here for a panel on the opioid crisis. So we hope you come back next week. Thank you.